Okay, so the current becoming more and more of a feature, and with it carrying the boards over the line, they need to be really careful not to start too soon. We've seen this happen to a few key players so far, and it's so expensive to have to go back and turn around again. Coming into the final 10 seconds before the start, and they're still not moving. How much time do they need to accelerate? We'll find out in a moment.
We'll see them start pumping.
And a very, very sharp, very late start by all of them, really hanging up on that line very late, but a great start by Ivan Pastor, the Spanish board here, closest to picture, with Shaha Zubari just behind him. And everyone started cleanly. No one needs to go back. And now it's wind whacking. What are they doing, Saskia? Why are they fanning the sail quite like that?
It's a squat down and then you power through your legs and push up and really pull that sail as powerfully and as fast towards you as you can. And that basically just accelerates the wind off the sail and gives you a squirt forward. And then you go into another squat and do the same again. And if you're a windsurfer, you are lucky enough to do that for 20 minutes non-stop to get you around the course the fastest. So right now, this is the fittest survive, you know.
So this is max heart rate stuff. Their hearts are pumping through their chest wall right now. You can't really get a sense just looking at that of how physical it is, maybe, but they are working at absolute maximum physical capacity.
Yeah, they are. And they're just sort of trying to get themselves a space and a lane so they might be able to just sort of hook in and give themselves a bit of breathing. But, you know, chances are that the guy that can do that long enough and most efficiently will be the guy that comes out, pops out and gives himself the space.
A few lead changes going on there, but let's just go back and look at the start again and see what we can work out from that. So Ivan Pastor, the Spanish board closest to us, got a fantastic start at this end, but we don't see him up amongst the leaders in the early stages. So it's not all about the start, that much we do know. And other good starts by the Briton Tom Squires in the middle of the fleet. But there's looks like there's going to be a lot of place changing going on this first race up the course.
So they sort of seem to be in the wind zone, which is really key for the windsurfers. About 10 knots for the men, I've sort of been reliably informed that you can actually get up and planing. And so if it's less than that, you'll be pumping the whole way around the course. If you're sort of around that kind of transition zone, you're trying to pump to get yourself onto the plane. And that's, you know, we sort of saw that with the Nacras a bit. You know, they were just slow and stopped and sticky in the water. If they got a puff of wind, they took off and zoomed. And it's sort of very similar with the boards. So this guy right now, he is definitely slow and displacement sailing. So his angles are higher, a bit more what we'd be used to in dinghy angles. But these guys out on the right-hand side, they look like they might be up and going.
So it's all about the breeze at the moment. Even though we've got a strong tidal effect, they're ignoring the tidal effect. Is that right?
Well, as we said, the tidal effect's fairly even across that race course. It's pushing them up towards this windward mark, so it's going to help them. They're going to have to work even harder downwind to try and push against that. So the tide is taking them up. An effect of where it's going to be a problem for them will be these ley lines and what their position they come into on that mark. But certainly when the breeze is in this marginal conditions, as I said, when one of them get up and accelerate onto the plane, there's a radical speed difference. And so a change of height and a change of angle and speed, and it's working out that happy medium of where they want to be sailing.
And when we looked at Thomas Goyard just a minute ago, he looked virtually stopped. And then in one of those last shots just then, the board was up and planing, and it was a dramatic difference in a very short space of time. And so we see how dynamic these boats are and how quickly things, boards are, and how quickly things can change. Matteo Lanz leading this race at the moment with the cross of the Swiss flag on his sail, just bouncing that sail, trying to eke out every bit of speed that he can in the lighter breezes.
He got identified to me as, you know, a super light wind specialist. He's the lightest in the fleet, 59 kilos. So, you know, he probably loves a light wind day. But he also, I think he's grown up on one of the Spanish islands, actually. So probably he's done a lot of wave and ocean sailing as well. So he can actually, he manages to sort of outsail his weight in the wind and waves as well. So he's, I think he's a young guy, obviously on the small side, but you know, might have a promising future.
And so what's the benefit of being lighter in light winds?
Just simply less weight to drag around the board on the, you know, around the course, and so you need less wind to get going fast. So it's just a sort of physics of less drag.
Okay.
And going back to that speed we were talking about, the difference of once you're up on the plane, when they're off in that displacement mode, it's literally a 4-5 knot sort of speed they're getting out of. We're seeing double that sort of upwind once they're onto the plane. So that's how quick and dramatic it is. If you can get these boards up onto the plane, then you can double your speed.
Wow. So even more dynamics than some of the lightweight skiff classes like the 49ers. Really, really need to find that pressure, find that breeze. We're on board on the front of the board of Kieran Badlow, who's wearing the yellow jersey, who is in good shape for taking the gold medal today. He's in third place in this race, and he's got good speed at the moment and could well be overtaking Thomas Goyard, who's gone further out to sea. Thomas Goyard just come out of a jibe and back up to speed again, but Kieran Badlow looks like he might be moving up into second. But a really nice lead for the 59 kilo lightest guy in the fleet, Matteo Lanz, way out in front, flying the flag for Switzerland. Two French sailors there, Louis Gillard, Thomas Goyard, battling it out for third place at the moment. And the French, possibly historically the strongest in this fleet, would you say, with either they or the Poles?
Yeah, I mean, so a number of countries have a bit of depth in this fleet. You know, the Dutch obviously have got Kieran here and Dorian. The French had a squad of four, I think, campaigning for that Rio slot. One of them was a previous medalist. He ended up becoming the coach, and a guy who's not here, I think, is Thomas, was the guy that went. They had a, you know, ferocious battle for that spot, and they're all top 10 guys, you know, so it's sort of interesting in this post-Olympic year how people sort of try and position their campaigns, and I think, you know, this year is kind of the year of the guys that didn't quite make qualification for Rio. You know, it's really their opportunity to come to the fleet fresh, because they didn't have all that sort of stress of the Olympic Games in that, you know, so they've come fresh and just ready to hit it hard, you know, with a chip on their shoulder that they didn't qualify, or they should have been the guys that qualified, and this is the chance to make their mark.
And is that why Dorian van Rieselberghe is sitting out some of the regattas this year, because it just takes so much out of you to do an Olympic campaign?
I actually watched the RSX men's Europeans were a month or so ago, and they had a really strong fleet. It didn't look like many of the Olympic guys had. They all were there, I think. It was pretty much an Olympic caliber fleet with obviously everyone in the mix. And I think Dorian lives in the States, so, you know, it's just sort of trying to balance what your priorities for the year with that, the amount of travelling that you need to do.
We saw Kieran Badlow hanging off a line off the wishbone of the handle that he holds onto the sail with. Why do they wear harnesses and why do they wear lines? Anyone know the answer to that?
If it was a bit windier, they wouldn't be pumping. They'd be hooked into the harness, and your harness would be taking the weight out of your arms. And so you'd be trimming the sail with your arms, but you wouldn't sort of be taking all that weight. At the moment, they're probably holding most of the weight of the sail in their arms, and they use their uphaul, which is sort of a technique. I don't know if it's been around for ages, but I do remember a lot of chat about it the last cycle. So you're sailing off your uphaul, and I think it gives you sort of better height.
And maybe you can lean out further. The uphaul is the rope that hangs down on the front of the mast. So I wonder if can you get your body weight further out? Yeah, we really don't have the right people in the room right now to answer those technical questions. If you want to write in and you're a windsurfer and you want to tell us the answer, then please contact us via YouTube, Facebook or Twitter. And if there's anything that you think we might know the answer to, then please ask us those questions as well. Meanwhile, the lightweight Matteo Lanz continues to stay ahead of Kieran Badlow and the big guys who are chasing him.
So really interesting what we've seen on this race course. A lot of the boards sticking to that middle of the course, really playing the shifts up that middle of the course, knowing that the tide's fairly even, but the opportunity of getting out of it downwind, getting over towards that sandbank, they all favoured as we look back downwind on that right side of course, but as they're taking this second upwind leg, a lot more sort of shifts being taken in the middle and separation, and certainly we're seeing Kieran Badlow keeping himself in that prime position in the middle to take any opportunity of taking any advantages.
Whereas what we see now is Louis Gillard ploughing a lonely furrow out to the left-hand side, chancing his arm on what he can find out on that side of the course. So Louis Gillard came in where today? He's in second place coming into today. And maybe, I wonder why he's going so extreme on his tactics and sailing away from the rest of the fleet. He should be keeping his eye on the Israeli boat, Israeli board primarily, shouldn't he, Sess?
Yeah, I mean, I think it got up the first upwind, and you see that Kieran is well placed, in third or second. So you sort of at that point you reassess, and you're not attacking for first anymore because that was quite a long shot anyway. And you're looking backwards, and you're seeing where your other guys are. So he's got Shaha, Israel 54 in third place overall, and they must be sort of tacking around with each other. He has got a bit of a gap on him. Shaha needs to get three boats between him and Louis to sort of get up into silver medal. But I think it's so costly to tack the board. You know, it takes anyone who's watching the AC, it's a bit similar to that. You know, it's a big deal tacking. It's a big loss in distance. So maybe Louis just fancies not doing as many manoeuvres. They've been a lot more central than maybe we'd all sort of expect windsurfers to be. I think we would sort of expect windsurfers to hit the corners a bit more and not play the shifts as much as they did that beat.
And Kieran Badlow now on the right of our picture, really working his sail incredibly hard. Big, tall, skinny physique and really putting a lot of power through that sail. I wonder how much that helps you in terms of trying to close the gap on a sailor that's shorter and lighter than you. I guess Kieran's having to work a lot harder than Matteo Lanz to maintain the same speed as the smaller Swiss sailor. That would be my guess. I mean,
it's all levers though in physics, isn't it? For every pump, Kieran probably has a bigger, wider range of travel with that. So his pump, the effect of his pump might last longer.
Right.
As we picked up on the fitness side, well, and Sass will be very queued up on in the sense of, the more physical exertion you put in, you've got to also still keep that mental clarity on what's going on the race course. You can bury yourself into something and pump and put yourself into a physical point, but there's got to be a recovery situation afterwards, and so being able to balance that mental awareness, so it is a real fine balance that they're working at. And yeah, these are some of the fittest waterborne athletes sort of on the water, but having that balance is also not just a tactical side, is also a physical element to where you can push yourself to.
It looks like the breeze has picked up for them, so they've got more planing going on. Does that mean they can work a little bit less hard once the breeze picks up?
Yeah, I mean, I think once you're sort of up, and I think they call it being up planing, and you're on sort of on your fin, I think you can then relax comparatively to what we've seen in the first half of the race. But I think on the upwind, it still does look like they're in that transition phase. They're not solidly planing. So it's a mix and match between the two styles, and the two styles are very different sort of strategy wise and tactically wise. Then if they're in displacement mode, it's much more similar to what we would all recognise as sort of more dinghy tactics. If they're planing, their angles are wider, and they're sort of doing fast boat tactics.
Okay.
So in a crossover race like this, where it's kind of crossing over those two styles, to be honest, I don't really know how you attack it.
Well, there's plenty of people enjoying the sun of Santander on the shores today on a beautiful weekend in northern Spain. Very, very changeable conditions that you can get here. We're seeing changeable conditions even during the course of one day, but it really is an all-rounders kind of venue. And is that what you found when you raced here in 2014, Saskia?
Yeah, I think that's what we'd really describe it. It's a real sort of sailor's venue, if you know what I mean. The outside, it's really really tricky sea state. So to get good just that sailing your boat in a straight line, your boat or board in a straight line in those conditions is quite tricky, but you have to be good at that to then give yourself the headspace to make all the decisions and the observations that you need to make. So it really rewarded spending some time out here and getting used to that sea state. And then conditions-wise, inside the harbour, it's flatter water, so that was obviously easier, but big tidal influence.
We just saw an example with Matteo Lanz. He was holding on to his uphaul, that rope, and we can just... Oh, yep, there we see exactly on cue. Kieran Badlow heard my words, and you can see that he just changes his stance. His right hand is now holding on to the uphaul, and either it's to get more pointing or it's to get your body weight out. We haven't quite determined what that is, but seems to be a trick they get out of the bag every so often. You sort of wonder why they do it sometimes and don't do it all of the time.
I think it's something to do with getting the mast further over to weather, but without the sail, if you know what I mean. So that if you pull the downhaul, you're pulling directly on the mast, but you're not. If you did that with your arms, you'd also be pulling the sail with you.
Right. So slightly different configuration of getting. Would you get more lift off the sail by pulling the mast over on top of you a little bit more?
One physics question too far for me.
The boards always have the rigs over on top of them. Occasionally you see boats like you sail, the 470, do that to a small degree. It's something we're seeing in the America's Cup as well, actually, with New Zealand. They're managing to cant their rig to windward a little bit, trying to copy the kind of the efficiency of the windsurfer rig, trying to get a little bit of lift out of it as well as forward drive.
I think with the AC, there's the added dimension of your two rudders in the water kind of thing. And I think that there's something going on with the sort of flexibility of your platform, if you know what I mean. So these guys don't have that. They're not hydrofoiling. In the 470, it definitely is a fast way to sail. It's a really unforgiving way to sail. Like if you get it wrong when you're over to windward, the losses can be huge, you know. So you have to be really, really on it to not go too far and have a sort of pretty much disastrous slip sideways.
So flat is still a fairly fast and a much safer way to sail a boat rather than having the mast leaning over to one side.
It's just a bit more forgiving. If you're over to windward, it takes a lot of concentration, and then that means you don't have as much concentration space for your tactics and your strategy and your observations. So, different people have different styles, and different conditions require different styles. You know, if it's a light wind day and it's all about speed because it's all about holding your lane out to left or something off the start line, you'll be prepared to sort of sacrifice some of that brain space that you'd normally put to sort of communication tactics. You'd put it all into sailing fast to that get to that left-hand side. Other days, shifty days, you need to maybe sacrifice a bit of speed so you can make those observations around you.
So, yeah, brain space is an interesting thought. And one of the interesting things about a lot of topsailers is how much they're able to look over their shoulder. Every time most people look over their shoulder, the boat speed drops down. But the very best sailors seem to be able to keep the boat or the board going very smoothly and still look over their shoulder to see where their competitors are, see where the breeze is coming from. That's Kieran Badlow coming round the top mark there, still trying to catch up Matteo Lanz, but Kieran Badlow looking very, very comfortable for winning the gold medal as he just carves the board through a beautiful jibe and straight up to speed again. Almost no loss of speed through that jibe and planing very nicely. He's about 6'3" tall. Picked up a nice suntan this week in Santander as well. And they're quite distinctive, aren't they? The physique of the windsurfers, very tall and skinny.
Yeah, I mean these guys aren't just sort of the athletes of the sailing world. They would hold their own with any Olympic athletes, you know, endurance Olympic athletes. It is full on. That's 20 minutes, or whatever it's going to be, of flat out heart rate, you know, of workload. So they really are. They work. And so when they're not sailing, they do a lot of effort on the bike. They sort of, obviously for their physiological effects, but also they, they're all pretty skinny, you know, they're just stripped down, not much fat on them, so they're just optimized for windsurfing.
Any idea what sort of percentage body fat we're talking about?
I mean, surely it definitely depends on your venue you're going to. And so if we look back to the China Olympics, all of us were rolling around very skinny, you know, down to sort of 7%, some of the guys and stuff. If you've got a windy venue, that, you know, that would be less of a focus, and you can afford to eat a few pies for it.
Well, here's someone who could afford to eat a few pies, is Matteo Lanz, just 59 kilos, making the best of these light wind conditions in the final race of the RSX men here in Santander at the World Cup Series final. And he's managing to keep Kieran Badlow at bay. Kieran Badlow having to settle for second place at best, it looks like, in this race. There's not too much of the race left to go. But Kieran Badlow won't care too much about that, because what he wants is the gold medal. He wants to become the World Cup Series champion 2017. And at the moment, the tall sailor from the Netherlands looks in very good shape to do that. Shahar Zubari from Israel up into third, also looking well placed for a medal. Will it be enough to overtake Louis Gillard for silver? We'll have to wait and see on that. Shahar Zubari, one of the Israeli representatives. Not an awful lot of sailors coming out of Israel, it seems. Pretty small programs that they run, but this is tight coming in round these marks. Shahar Zubari. Ooh.
This actually might be a big deal for the overall. If Shahar's got first, where's the French guy?
So Shahar Zubari, has he overtaken?
He needs three boats between him and the French guy.
So very, very close for bronze and silver right now. Shahar Zubari doing what he needs to do. Matteo Lanz, he's led so much of this race, hasn't managed to keep the Israeli at bay. Shahar Zubari somehow managed to overtake both Matteo Lanz and Kieran Badlow on that run. And going across the finish line, it's going to be Israel first, Switzerland second, and Kieran Badlow of the Netherlands in third place. And that will be enough to give gold to Kieran Badlow from the Netherlands, who now becomes the World Cup Series champion in the RSX men. So congratulations to him, continuing to fly the flag for the Netherlands in an event that they've dominated in recent years. Certainly at the Olympic Games they've dominated, and here at one of the major events of the year, once again, it's Netherlands that take gold. And Shahar Zubari looking extremely happy. He punches the air. He's about a high five. He does with his coach. He did all he could do. He came from nowhere on that final run. He came past the Swiss sailor, Matteo Lanz. He came past the Netherlands. Just tell us, Corky, how he managed to do that.
Well, really interesting. The front two boards, Kieran and the Swiss sailor, both getting really mixed into each other. And just Kieran was just jibing and mirroring everything the Swiss sailor did. And they got too focused on each other, really, and were just trying to feel they had the position. And that just let the Israeli Zubari just be able to shoot down on that separate side, clean air, clean water, and be able to attack them right at that final point into that last gate mark and give himself the run to the finish. So superb racing, and it shows that if you get yourself too focused on one competitor, that it can quickly flip the tables on that. Obviously for Kieran, it was all about just securing a nice, solid, comfortable race to take that gold medal, which he did, but certainly it shows that every single race comes right down to the wire.